Oregano, companion plant or intercropper?
Cosmos,
companion plant or intercropper? Lettuce, intercropper or companion plant? It's a very real question, and there's a big difference between companion planting and intercropping, so let's talk about it. We've constantly been told about companion planting, and we don't very often talk about intercropping, and we actually mix up companion plants as intercropping plants. And while they're basically the same lingo, they actually serve very different purposes. And so today's video, we're gonna be going over what is a companion plant, what's an intercropping plant, and what's a trap crop, which is a form of companion planting, if you will. So first off, trap cropping. We talked about this in the flea beetle video, but a trap crop is essentially a crop that pests find particularly appealing. Nasturtiums is a great example of this as well. And these plants are tasty to things like aphids or flea beetles or horned worms, whatever the case is. You want to research that crop, find it, find which seeds are the cheapest to purchase from it, then actually sow those seeds in and amongst the plant that you want to grow that is affected by these pests. This will actually attract the pests to the crop that is most heavily cropped, such as in the case of nasturtiums. If we put a ton of nasturtiums in my tomato bed, we'll have less aphid problems on the tomatoes specifically. Now, the concept here actually isn't to leave the trap crop in place, it is to let it accumulate a ton of aphids and then actually dispose of it so that we can reduce the population over time. And then you would put the new trap crop back in place, which again would be nasturtiums, and you would just keep this rotating cycle. So in many cases for trap cropping, you may want to consider intersowing it every 2 weeks, doing a pile of them, or actually doing things from starts every 2 weeks, and then putting them in, pulling them out, putting them in, pulling them out. It's just a very organic way of dealing with pests. It's a form of companion planting, but technically it's considered trap cropping in the world of horticulture. Now the next one is actually intercropping. So if you look behind me here, we have a beautiful tomato bed. And inside of this tomato bed, our tomatoes aren't really established. There's a lot of bare space, and it seems like kind of a misuse of space, if you will. Now, if you watch my videos in the past, you know that these beds get very, very full and tomato plants get absolutely massive over time, and therefore nothing else can be planted in there, unless if you intercrop. So a form of intercropping could include using things like herbs, oregano, basil, for example, or lettuces, head lettuce or leaf lettuce, spinaches, arugulas, radishes, things with a quick turnaround time, usually 30 to 40 days to harvest, and intercropping them with the tomatoes. This will allow you to get a harvest, usually around the end of June, from those lower hanging type veggies, until those tomatoes take over the bed and nothing else can be intercropped in that space. It's a utilization of the space that's currently not being used will be absolutely infested with leaves and tomatoes in the coming months. So this is a form of intercropping. Another form of intercropping could be for your visual appeal. So instead of doing classic row cropping, which would simply be rows of lettuce, rows of spinach, rows of radishes, rows of tomatoes, etc. and so forth, you may want to mix and match things so it looks more appealing to the eye. So you could do kale, so a nice lactinio kale, really tall, combined with like a head lettuce beside it, and then a head lettuce on the other side, and maybe a radish and a radish. And so it's kind of like a way of pattern planting. It can reduce pest suppression, and it may result in kind of like a trap crop form of way of growing, but it's very pretty. It's appealing to the eye, it lets you mix and match colors, and it's a great utilization of your space, again, if you're utilizing tall plants with short plants that don't necessarily shade each other out. Now, companion planting is a little bit different. Companion planting is the utilization of plants that go well with other plants. And the benefits of a companion plant may consist of, for example, in the form of a legume crop, the implementation of nitrogen fixation with a heavy feeder such as corn. So one of the most famous examples of this is the Three Sisters method. Three Sister method uses corn combined with pole beans. The pole beans nitrogen fix for the corn, and then the corn uptakes that nitrogen and it acts as a stock. Now, there's not much evidence to suggest the nodulation or the nitrogen fixation that goes on in the nodules is immediately bioavailable to the corn in that first growing season. It's usually over time that it becomes bioavailable. And so that legume crop doesn't benefit you in that first year. It usually will benefit you in the second and third. So do keep that, take that with a grain of salt, but it is a form of companion cropping that is very popular. Now, another form of companion cropping would be the spaghetti squash, or a squash with a tall plant like corn or sunflowers or tomatoes. Now, the reason for this is because these plants don't provide much ground cover. And so if you're not using mulches and you're not using ways to preserve your soil from soil erosion, the utilization of vines or heavy ground cover like sweet potatoes, for example, will actually help to stabilize that soil against soil erosion, provide much needed shading of both the roots and the soil itself, which can actually cool the soil and help with just moisture retention in general. So you could use companion cropping in that sense. And the other way to use companion cropping would be the attraction of pollinators or beneficial bugs. So this can come in the form of, in some cases, of like really pretty flowers that will encourage things like hummingbirds or bees to come by, pollinators to come by and actually pollinate your zucchinis or your spaghetti squash or your tomatoes, whatever the case is. Now, the other form of this would actually be to attract predatory beneficial bugs, so ladybugs, for example. If you know of a plant that ladybugs really enjoy, you could intercrop with that, and those ladybugs would then eat the aphids. So if you're growing lettuce, which is prone to be attacked by aphids, unfortunately, you could intercrop with something that ladybugs really think is tasty and awesome to hang out on, and therefore that will bring them in to get rid of your aphid population. Now, the other form of companion cropping, if you will, that's not there's not much science to back this up, but it's still something that people swear by, is the intercropping of like marigolds and tomatoes, for example, because it's said that marigolds and, you know, citronella, for example, will repel certain pests based on the oils they give off, the smell that they give off, the aphrodisiac they give off. Now, there isn't much science to support that this is the case. I haven't found anything, you know, super compelling that I'm like, yeah, guys, like this works. But there's no harm in intercropping, you know, marigolds, for example. I intercrop marigolds because I think they're really pretty. They, you know, pollinators love them. So even if it's not deflecting a pest, it will bring in pollinators. There's no harm in it. But just don't put all your eggs in one basket thinking that a marigold's gonna, you know, protect you against a specific pest. That may not always be the case, so do keep that in mind. But I hope this helped you guys out on the difference between trap, companion, and intercropping. Those are the three ways or three methods of which you can garden. Which one's your favorite? Which is your favorite plant to intercrop with? I'd love to hear in the comments down below, and I will talk to you next time. Bye!